All attempts in our world to change the rules so that people of God face a choice: compromise or face the consequences.
What's your passion? What is something that you really feel strongly about that you need to do something about?
The prediction in the Old Testament of the coming of Jesus was with remarkable accuracy. The same with the second coming of Jesus. And this same God allowed himself to be nailed to a cross to save.
Oh, Well, this is not my usual position. I feel very comfortable in the coffee shop. But Steve asked me if I would share my story with you this morning. My story is probably not terribly different to the story of many of you here. My story is one of great pain, but great triumph. And today I stand here as a woman who is faithful to a faithful God, to a God who has never failed me. I found my problems, while they were great, he was greater. And so while you might shed a tear or feel sad about some of the things I'm going to say, because this is my story, just like you have your story, I want you to know that I stand here in the power of Jesus Christ, that he is my Lord and my Saviour, and never once has he failed me. As many of you know, my life has been one of music, or some of you may not know that. But music is very important in my life. When I was younger, I used to do a lot of singing. I was pulled out of bed at 6 o'clock in the morning by my dad to make me practice the piano on cold mornings in Stanthorpe, and that was no fun. But I'm so glad he made me do that, because today I love playing my piano. And then the Lord led us into the whole area of music with the running of a Christian record company, and that was another story. I am very, very grateful that I grew up in a very strong Christian home. In fact, I remember my mum speaking about her great-grandmother loving the Lord. And so my heritage and the heritage that we've been able to pass on through the Lord to our grandchildren is a very long and rich one. I used to laughing and jokingly say, my father and mother had a scripture verse for every time I complained. It didn't matter whether I didn't want to eat my food. You are glad you have food, that God has provided this food. If you didn't want to do something, then you do everything as unto the Lord and to his glory. And so it didn't matter. Everything had an accompanying verse. And I'm really glad of that, because today I think I probably did that to my children. And I'm probably pretty sure that they do that to their kids sometimes as well. But a Christian heritage is very, very real. Keith, okay, can I have a glass? My bottle. I've left my bottle of water down there. I'm getting very dry. So my Christian heritage is very real and very, very precious. Thanks, Steve. Sorry. Does anyone else get a dry mouth when they're nervous? I gave my life to the Lord when I was quite young. And when I was probably in my early teens, I really felt the Lord was calling me to full-time ministry. I wasn't sure what that looked like. As a woman, it cut down my options somewhat. And so therefore, I probably thought the Lord wanted me on the mission field, because women were readily accepted there. And so I set my face towards doing medicine and studying at university and going to the mission field as a medical doctor. But as time went on and circumstances changed, I started to understand that's probably not where the Lord wanted me. And then my pastor one day told me about a course that the Baptist Theological College was offering to women to work in Baptist churches in various roles. I always had a real heart for youth and Christian education. I loved going into the schools. I loved talking to young people. I still do. And so when I finished grade 12, I went through and applied to go into the Baptist Theological College. And there I did 3 years training, and it was there that I met Keith. After I had finished my training, I was called to be the assistant as a deaconess at a big church in the city. The pastor that I was working beside was wonderful. We had a wonderful ministry. We worked together so well. I did youth Bible studies. I worked with the brigades. I did a lot of school work in the schools with religious education. And we were having a great time. I was learning so much, working beside him. But then one day, at the time, I felt my world fall apart because the Baptist Union had asked him if he would leave the church that we were working together in and plant a church up on the Atherton Tableland. And I say I was devastated because I had just so got used to working with this guy, and it was such a great relationship. I was learning so much. I was still very young. When Rob left, it meant that I was the only full-time worker in the church. I want you to remember that we're talking about 55, 60 years ago. I'm giving my age away, aren't I? And that was really, really confronting for me. So what were we going to do? We had a great group of godly men, mature men, who were the elders in that church. So we rang the Baptist Union and we said to them, well, you've taken our pastor away. You better step in and help us here. So they came out. We all met together with the elders, myself and the Baptist Union. We sat down. It was a big church, so this was no small thing. We also had two church plants. One was Rochdale Baptist and one was Woodridge Baptist. So not only did we have the big church, but we had these two smaller churches. So we sat down and we made a list. This was all the things. These were all the things that needed to be done. How were we going to divvy this out? And so that's what we did. But I said straight up, I can't do funerals. I won't do weddings. I'm way too young. I'm not even married myself. There were certain things that I would put my line, across my line through. And so the rest of the things we worked through on who was going to do what. I said to them at the time that preaching was something that was hard work for me. I didn't feel it was my natural gifting, but I was prepared. This was like we needed everybody to pull their weight in this situation. And so it was that I said to them, I'll do one a month. That's all I'm prepared to do. And so I preached at the youth service in the big church, and then I preached at Woodridge Church. The smaller church was only a Sunday school at that stage. And so this happened many, many years ago. And so I was thrown in the deep end. I could never have done this without the tremendous support of those godly men. And I'm just saying to the men this morning, if you're prepared to listen, you have a wonderful role in supporting your wives, your children. Don't ever underestimate how important your role is in supporting women in their ministry. It's a vital role. So we got through that, and after a few years, Keith and I were married. And we went down and pastored two churches on the Gold Coast. It was exciting. It was an exciting time. Gold Coast is a great place to pastor churches. It was very seasonal because there were visitors at some stages and things were quieter at other stages. We had a little boy, which was wonderful. Then we had a little girl, which was great. So we had our pigeon pair, and then I was pregnant with our third child, and life was good. Life was great. We had it all worked out. And it was just before Christmas, And I remember that I'd made special little outfits for the two kids, and they were matching, of course, and everything was going well. Because I was pregnant and the baby was due not long after Christmas, I was very organised. All the Christmas presents were made, were done and packed under the tree. So I was super organised. Keith had said he would take a group of Boys Brigade boys up to my parents' property in Stanthorpe. And so we went up to Stanthorpe on the Monday and for a few days with the Boys Brigade. And we were due to come back, or I think it was on the Thursday. And Thursday morning, Sonia woke up and she just wasn't terribly well. She wasn't terribly sick either. She just wasn't quite right. And I said to Keith, because it was Christmas time and because I was pregnant and didn't want the hassles of sick children, I said to Keith, let's take her to the doctor. Without going through all the circumstances, within 24 hours, we'd lost her. Our lives were shattered. You're young, you think you've got life all worked out. She was 18 months old. She was a beautiful little girl. So God, where are you? Have you ever been like the disciples that were in the boat with Jesus and they said, Lord, don't you care? That's the way I felt. Lord, where are you? What is this all about? We're serving you. We're doing what we believe, God, you have called us to do. What is going on? The feelings, the hopelessness. If you've been through this, and some of you I'm sure have, you know what I'm talking about. And so we put our little girl and left her with the Lord and tried to get on with our life. But it was like the Lord said to me, you know what? For the last 28 years, you've talked about me. You've shared your faith. You've gone into schools. You've told kids about your faith. So where is it now? Is it going to work? Or are you going to go and sit in the corner and just pull a blanket over your head and die? Because I can tell you now, that would have been an easy option. Because hope just seems to die sometimes until you really stop and think about it. And at this point, the devil comes in and then he starts to assault you. And he assaulted me. He told me I was a useless mother. Mums, when you bring your baby home from the hospital, they can't feed, they can't look after themselves. They can't go to the toilet. That child is totally dependent on you. And if you don't look after that child, they will die. Mine did. So what did that mean? I was useless as a mother. And the devil wanted me to believe that. He wanted me to believe that with all my heart. But very quickly, I came to realise two things. There's conviction and there's condemnation. When we're convicted, the Holy Spirit gently guides us. But when we're under condemnation, that is not from God. That is not from God. When you hear a voice that says to you, you're useless, you're no good, you're a failure, that is not from God. And the devil played havoc with me. For 4 years, I lived in a constant state of battling. Last week, Steve preached about many things, but he mentioned about the breastplate, the fruit of the spirits, the armor that we need to put on, the spiritual battle that we have to fight. And that's what I was fighting. Christmas came and went. And on my birthday, 3 weeks after Sonia's death, the phone rang. And it was Keith's dad to say, "I just found your mum dead on the floor." God, where are you? Lord, what are you doing to us? It was unbelievable that this could be happening again. And I remember sitting at the funeral chapel, and I was numb from my own grief. And I remember just thinking, this is not happening. This can't be happening. But at the same time, the Lord was saying to me, "I am with you. Did I not promise I will never leave you or forsake you? Did I promise my grace is sufficient for you? Did I promise you can do all things through Christ who gives you the strength? Did I say to you, when you're weak, then I'm strong?" And I used to get those Bible verses and I would pump them through my life. All the time, every step. Sometimes, you know, they say one day at a time. Honestly, some days for me, it was 1 hour at a time. It was one step at a time. 3 weeks after this, we received our little boy into our family. And he brought a lot of joy. And life was moving on very slowly. Ministry kept going. And at that stage, I remember thinking, do you know, pastors have all the answers. Did you know that? Pastors never have any questions. They only have the answers. They're always strong. They're never weak. They never have any problems. They're always on top of life. Wrong, wrong, wrong. Pastor Steve, Jabin, so, so wrong. Because during that period when we'd lost our little girl, we'd lost mum, our little boy was born, ministry kept on happening. And we were supposed to show up with a smile. Keith had organised an outreach through Christian Surfboard Riders. We were young in those days. And he was a keen surfboard rider. And there was a big ministry with surfboard riders in Sydney. And they had approached Keith, I think that was the story, to come up and do an outreach onto the Gold Coast. And that was the month that Mum died and after Sonia had died. And I remember us being down and we were ministering to all these kids with their surfboards and this was the Jesus Revolution era, remember? And so it was wonderful and God was blessing, but we were tired. We were tired. And Keith said in the end, "I can't do this anymore. I've got nothing left to give. I have nothing left to give. We've got to go. We've got to do something else. We've just got to take a break." What are we going to do? You see, when I felt the Lord calling me, I felt that was for life. Then I met my husband, who is a pastor. That's what I thought we'd do for the rest of our lives. But God was shaking our world. God had a better idea. You know, God had a better idea. He was shaking us up. And so what can you do that's totally different to pastoring? You go and work for Woolworths. You go and learn how to be a department manager in Woolworths. What we didn't know then, we thought was just a stopgap. But what we didn't know was God was laying a foundation for what was to follow. He did that for 12 months. And after some time, the Lord very graciously gave us another beautiful little girl. She could never replace, but she was another little girl for us to hold and have in our family, to complete our family, so we thought. And she brought so much healing. She's here this morning, and I know that we've told her this many times, but she brought so much healing. But she also brought with us this new area of attack for the devil. You see, you're going to let her die too. That was the dialogue. That was the narrative that started to play in my mind. You let the other little girl die, so you're going to let her die too. You can't look after her like you couldn't look after the other one. The devil is a liar. And sometimes when I could say nothing. I didn't even know how to pray. I would just say, Jesus, 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 because I believe this power in the name of Jesus. I was out of words. I was out of thoughts. But I did recognize very quickly. But those fears were real. And the Lord raised up for me a wonderful, wonderful lady. She never sang. She never played the piano. She didn't sing in the choir. She didn't speak. She was just a wonderful lady, very quietly in the congregation. And she knew the battle that I was going through, because during this time, the Lord had called us back into ministry. The church was Holland Park, which now is Gateway. And we were pastoring in this church, and this was all going on, this battle with fear. I'm trying to stick to my 30, 40 minutes here, Steve. And so I'm having to jump a little bit over things. It's hard to squeeze 55 years of ministry into 30 minutes. But this lady knew the struggles that I was having. And so when one of the children looked like they were getting sick, I would spiral. I would just spiral. And they'd only need to, you know how often children will spit up? It happens all the time. That was enough to set me off. And this lady would turn up on my door. She'd go and get the pajamas, a clean set of clothes, a basket full of ironing, which was always there when you've got three little kids, and she would take the children away. She would say to me and Keith, you go and spend the day at Mount Tamarine, or you go and spend the day somewhere. She was an angel. And the Lord provided her for me. She will never know. She's not with us anymore. But she will never know the healing that she helped to bring into my life at that time. I'm just looking at some of my notes here, and I just want to share this little story with you. Because this is how the Lord can, he never asks you to do anything without he equips you. Do you believe that? If he asks you to do something, he will equip you to do it. And I remember it was just probably two years after Sonia died. And we were in church one Sunday morning. Keith was in the pulpit preaching. And the church secretary came in and said, I need to talk to you. And I was sitting up the back with the children. He said, I need to talk to you. And he said, there's a couple. I, I was leading a youth Bible study group, young adults Bible study group at that time. And there was a young couple in the Bible study group that were expecting their first baby. I knew she'd gone into labour, but I didn't think much about it. We waited for the news to come through. And the church secretary said to me, Ruth has had her baby and there were complications and she's not going to live. And Ruth needs you. No, Lord. Have you ever said no, Lord? Such a contradiction of terms, isn't it? But I just said, no, Lord. No, 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 no. I've just lost my baby. Do you know what you're asking me to do? I can't do that. No, Lord, I can't do that. And my friend knew something was going on and she came out to see what was going on. And I said to her, Alison, I can't do this. I can't go up to the hospital. And I looked up, where's Keith? He should be, this is his job. He was busy. And the church secretary very kindly said to me, you have to do it. And Alison stepped up and said, I'll look after the children. You go. I couldn't believe what I was being asked to do. And I thought, Lord, if you want me to do this, you better help me. You better show up for me on this one. And I went up to the Mater Mothers and there was Ruth and we just hugged. You know, there are no words when someone dies. There are no words. All you need is someone to say, I love you, give you a hug. I'm praying for you. That's all. That's the very best thing. Because you know what? Words come out all wrong. And I had some awful things said to me. But I knew they were trying to be kind. Like, isn't it lovely that you're pregnant and having another baby? Because that means you won't miss that one so much. Really? So just a word to say, when someone has lost someone, and I know I'm speaking to many people here who have been in this situation, there are no words. Just love them. Just pray for them. It's the very, very best thing that you can do them. So the Lord taught me a big lesson that day. If I'm going to ask you to do something, you better believe I'm with you and I'm going to equip you. I sat in that hospital. I was able to nurse the little thing, just a sweet little full-term baby, and she passed into eternity. And it was such a moment of breakthrough with another step in my understanding the reality of Jesus Christ in my life and his power to equip and give us everything we need to do what he wants us to do. So time passed and the church was going well. Before we were married, Keith had become very involved in Christian television and radio. He was presenting radio programs, he was presenting TV programs. And so his ministry with Christian radio and television was quite extensive. After a few years, 3 or 4 years at Holland Park, he felt the Lord was leading him to something else. And the Baptist bookstore operated in the city at that stage. And he felt that that was where the Lord wanted him to go. And I was like, no, 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 Keith, you're wrong. I married a pastor in a pastoral ministry, not a pastor who works in a Christian bookstore. But once again, the Lord had to show me that I was wrong because he applied for that job and he got the job. And so our life did another U-turn. He had just started at the bookstore. We'd moved house. The Lord had blessed us with another little girl, which was a great surprise. But once again, This little girl, I think she might be here too. That little girl showed me I was a good mum. Time had passed and she just grew like Topsy. She was just one of those, you know, mums, you know what I'm talking about? One of those easy kids. You know, they don't cry a lot. They're full of life. They don't get sick very often. And I remember looking at her one day when I was changing her nappy. And I looked at her chunky little legs. And the Lord said in my mind, you see, you are a good mum. You are a good mum. And so Keith and I often say, we have the family that the God planned for us. We had a plan. It was a boy, a girl, and perhaps another one. But that wasn't his plan. So we finished up with two great sons and two beautiful daughters. He always knows best. He always knows best. Kylie was just 12 months old. Keith had started a new job. We'd moved house. All very high stress situations. Once again, the phone rings at 3 o'clock in the morning. My mum had passed away. No warning. She was 62. No warning. The thing that with all of the deaths in our family has been sudden. No time to say goodbye. Just, that's it. Get on with it. Deal with it. I struggled with the death of my mum because on the way to her funeral in Stanthorpe, Keith and I had a bad car accident, and so I never got to the funeral. So while the funeral was on, I was in the Ipswich Hospital. So once again, I was with the disciples in the boat saying, Lord, where are you? Don't you care? Do you not care what's going on in our lives? I need to hurry. All the time this was going on, God was teaching us. God was leading us. God was directing us. In those years that passed by, the ministry of the bookstore continued to grow, and Keith was using his television and radio ministry quite a lot with the Youth for Christ and with other organisations, because what we found, or he found at that stage, was there was a big gap in the music ministry, in the Christian music ministry. Not a lot was being done. And so he got very involved with Christian music, and what he was doing with the bookstore and through the radio and television, working with concert promoting, working with Youth for Christ, that things were really on the roll. And one day we get a phone call, and once again he was out at Holland Park because he stayed on as associate even though we'd left there full time. He was out at Holland Park because they didn't have a pastor at the time, doing a wedding. And this lady said to me, I've got to speak to Keith. And I said, well, you can't speak to Keith because he's doing a wedding. I have to speak to him. Well, I'll get him to call you. What she was saying was, there's a big record company in America. They've heard about what you're doing and they would like to talk to you about setting up a wholesale distribution. Really? Well, it's just one problem there. We don't have any money. We don't have any money. How do you set up a wholesale distribution company? Big warehouses, staff. So Keith just believed that if the Lord wanted him to do something, he would equip him. Do you remember what I just said to you before? But I didn't have that much faith because I was like, the bank account said, we don't have any money. And the previous company that was doing the distribution of the music had got themselves into financial difficulty. And whoever took on the new distribution was asked to pick up the debt that was outstanding. Who does that? Well, the Brays do. This was 1986, and the amount of money was $200,000. Now, $200,000 in 1986 was a lot of money. But Keith just believed, and I watched him while he believed, that if the Lord wanted him to do this job, he would somehow, we didn't know how, he would somehow equip. And if you want to listen to the story, I'll have to tell you another time, because it's a long story. But just to say, God miraculously, through a man we had known for 4 days, who was also, they flew us to America for the interviews. We had known him for 4 days, and he was the senior pastor of a very large accounting company that looked after investments for wealthy people who had money that wanted to invest. And he went to Sparrow Records and he said to them, unbeknown to us, I believe the Brays are the people that you need to appoint. If you appoint them, we will get you the money. Can I just say to you, I still remember where I was when that phone call came through. I was sitting on the end of our bed in a big hotel in Washington, D.C., and can I just say, God had my full attention, 100% attention, because that was a miracle. And we went into that with so much confidence, knowing that that was where God wanted us. And through that company, and this was 1986, our children all grew into that. They came and they went, you know, sometimes with their interests. Technology has changed. The company changed. But the remnants of that company is still around. And can I say, if you went and saw the Jesus Revolution, it started back there. Bill, I think I'm right to say. The fruits of it, my son-in-law, who is now running his own company, distributes Christian movies through theatres. And if you went and saw War Room, or you went and saw God's Not Dead, or you saw Jesus Revolution, more than likely that may have come out of our family. It's amazing when you look back and see this was a pastor who we were just going to pastor for the rest of our lives. But God had other ideas. As the business continued to grow, our oldest son went to Nashville to live, to pursue musical interests. Our next son got married. And once again, just before Christmas, we get a phone call. It's our son to say, Danielle has had a stroke. She was 22. She was a bright young lady. She was a journalist. She had graduated from university with honours or distinctions, I think it was. She had her life ahead of her. And without any warning, she developed a blood clot on her brain. And the Lord took her home. I remember standing outside the church when she was buried. And her family was very well known in the Gatton Lockyer Valley area. So it was a very big funeral. And I stood outside and I watched our 4 children get into the same vehicle and drive off behind the hearse, because Jason just wanted to be with his siblings as he drove out to the cemetery. And I thanked the Lord for my kids. You know, we've had pain, but God's been so good. He's been so good. He has never left us. He has walked with us every step of the way. You know the song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. All I have needed, Your hand has provided. And through every trial and every testing and everything that's been thrown at our across our path, God has been faithful. He has given us everything we need. We have cried, please don't think this was easy. We've cried, we've despaired, but God never forgot us. Every trial we had, He was greater. His promises are true today, just like they were 2,000 years ago. I just want to leave you with the words of a song that I've asked the music team to close the service with. You know, it's not been easy for me to stand here and talk to you about this. I've laid bare some of my deep feelings that I've tried to put aside, you try to bury, that they're always there. But I want you to know that I stand before you today in the power of Jesus Christ. And I want you to know that that can be your experience too. That He has given us promises. That He has said, I will never leave you. My grace is sufficient. I can do all things. We are more than conquerors. All of those things are true in my life and can be true in your life. And today, you might be stuck in a place. You might be thinking, Lord, this situation that I'm in is unbearable. Where are you, Lord? Like the disciples, don't you care? Don't you care that we're perishing? Interestingly enough, those disciples were in the centre of God's will. Remember, He said, let's get in the boat and go across the lake. Jesus was asleep in the boat with them. They were with the Lord. But the storm still came and threatened, and they feared that they would drown. Lord, don't you care? We all feel that way sometimes. But I can tell you, the Lord does care. His promises are true. He is a faithful God. And today I stand in the power of Christ and share with you what my life experience has been. There's so much more to my life, but I don't have the time and I don't want to take up your time. But I just want you to know that He's the same today, yesterday, and forever. When Sonia died, I was sitting beside her bed in the hospital and I looked out the window. It was 4:30 in the morning and the sun was just rising. And as clearly, the Lord said to me, this is the day I have made. And what He was saying to me is, I haven't changed. Your world is on its head, but I haven't changed. I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if you're stuck in a place, I want to recommend my Jesus to you. I want to say to you, He's a good God. He loves you. And if you feel like this morning you need prayer, that you're stuck in a place, that your life is out of control, please, while we're singing this song, please feel free to come down. And Pastor Steve and I believe Sue will be here and we'll meet you. But I just want you to know He's a good God and we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us and gave Himself for us.
Cross alone, my hope is found. Christ alone my hope is found. He is our light. He is our strength. He is our song. May you walk away from the buildings today remembering that He is always the same today, yesterday, and tomorrow. May you be blessed and happy Mother's Day. Spend time with your family. Thank you.